سبحان الله وبحمده ربا العظيم سبحان الله وبحمده ربا العظيم سبحان الله وبحمده
Inshallah, in a very good style and with tajweed, this child has recited the Quran. May Allah Ta'ala make this child a practicing hafidh of Quran and an alim and a scholar. Ameen. Alhamdulillah, praise be to Allah. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytanir rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Allahu yajtabi ilayhi man yasha wa yahdi ilayhi man yunib. Allah draws unto Himself everyone who is willing, and guides unto Himself everyone who turns unto Him. وَالَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا فِينَا لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ سُبُلَنَا وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ لَمَعَ الْمُحْسِنِينَ But as for those who strive hard in our cause, we shall most certainly guide them onto paths that lead unto us. For behold, Allah is indeed with the doers of good. Brothers, Hazrat Sheikh Sahib, Hazrat Sheikh Asif Hussain Faruqi Sahib, Damat Barakatuhum, me, and the responsible members of this masjid, and in the same way, the ulama of our madrasa, the scholars of our madrasa, and the scholars of Manchester, we are from the depths of our heart very grateful that Hazrat, in this day and age, and in the environment we're living in, and he has given us a beautiful opportunity to host him in this gathering in our masjid. On Thursday, when along with my dear respected Hazrat Mulana Yaqub Sahib Damat Barakatum, when I showed to him that this is the post I've made for today's gathering, then we made the poster, and to get the approval of the poster, when I went and approached Hazrat Muhtaram, dear respected, our brother Iftikhar Bhai, Iftikhar Sahib, when we presented and showed him the poster, then he said, it's a nice poster, very good, but there are a couple of words that we need to withdraw, which Hazrat himself will not prefer. And those words were Hazrat Peer. And he said that Hazrat desires that these words are used for the elders, for our pious predecessors. And I am a low, humble servant of Allah. But I say, my brothers, that individual and personality through whom Allah Ta'ala is making him do such great work of the deen. And today, as much as he tries to conceal and hide himself and stay hidden, Allah Ta'ala is revealing him, publicizing him, and making him famous. Subhanallah. And further, if we go further to explain that Hazrat Sheikh Saab's own Sheikh, our grandfather Sheikh, Hazrat Ali Murtaza Rahmatullah Alayhi, who taught and gave permission to Hazrat Sheikh Saab Damat Barakatum, when he taught him the dhikr of Allah and gave him the permission himself to teach the dhikr of Allah, and he said that I give you permission to go forth and instill the dhikr of Allah into the hearts of the servants of Allah, and he sent Hazrat Sheikh Saab to Europe, to the UK, and dhikr that time started on Thursday night with two men started dhikr of Allah that time decades ago, and within a week the whole place of dhikr was full, and the more they tried to hide and conceal, Allah Ta'ala made them famous, apparent, publicized them to this extent that until a few days ago in Manchester we used to have two gatherings of dhikr a week, and Allah Ta'ala publicized it and made it so much apparent and multiplied it that nowadays, today in morning and evening in Masjid al-Zikriya there's the halakan gathering of dhikr, and all the evenings through the week in the masjids of Bolton there are the majlis, the gathering of dhikr of Allah. Allah Ta'ala has made it famous and apparent and publicized it. Allah Ta'ala has not hidden it. Allah Ta'ala has made it apparent. Yana, this nur of the dhikr of Allah, Allah says the barakah, the blessings of the dhikr of Allah, the nur, the nuraniyat of dhikr, it is not hidden. Allah Ta'ala said, I make it apparent, I spread it, I publicize it. And yani, the person who does dhikr, who is involved in dhikr and hosts and teaches dhikr, Allah Ta'ala himself does not hide that person. Allah Ta'ala reveals that person, makes his work famous, makes that person famous. This is the shan of Allah. Allah Ta'ala said that the person who is humble, sincere, who tries to hide, Allah Ta'ala publicizes him, increases his work, puts barakah in his work. And my brothers, myself personally, I am a witness of this, that just I will share a few words with you to explain the impact of what I've seen and witnessed. That until today I've seen such youngsters, I know them, I'm aware of them, whose life they grew up in my midst, under my eyes. For a few months I taught them in the Khankar myself, and then I left that position for a reason. Because mashallah, the children, they were sincere, their parents were sincere. And they used to come to the Khankar, they used to come to the madrasa in the Khankar in Manchester, where I taught. And the children would during the day make effort, strive, struggle, go to normal schools, they'd come home. And then they'd sometimes come late to the madrasa. And I used to say to the parents that the children are coming to the madrasa a bit late. If they can come early, it'd be beneficial for them. And the parents said, Ustad, that they come home from school 2:30, 3 o'clock, then they get ready, then they come to the madrasa 5 o'clock or 6 o'clock. And with their barakah, with their intention, they had jazbah. I had jazbah and passionate desire. I wanted to teach them fully, with the full time. But I had to leave that because I couldn't do it to the full effect, to the justice it needed. So I sought permission. And Hazrat, I sought permission and I understood the point at that time. But today, I saw those youngsters in that time. And today, mashallah, we see that those youngsters are here, present in the gathering, dressed in the sunnah attire, with the noor of the sunnah on their faces, wearing the imamah on their heads, the sunnah turban. In other words, on this land of Europe, in the UK, they are sitting as such youngsters who've grown up in this land, they're nationals of this country, and subhanAllah, I remember the verse of the Quran that comes from my mind, وَإِنَّ لَكُمْ فِي الْأَنْعَامِ لَعِبْرَةً نُسْقِيكُمْ مِمَّا فِي بُطُونِ مِنْ بَيْنِ فَرْثٍ وَدَمِّ اللَّبَانَنُ خَالِصًا سَائِغًا لِلشَّارِبِينَ. Allah says in this Quranic verse that, and behold, in the cattle too, there is indeed a lesson for you. We give you to drink of that fluid milk which is secreted from within their bellies, between that which is to be eliminated from the animal's body through their excrement and urine, and its lifeblood. But milk pure and pleasant is given to us, to those who drink it. In other words, Allah Ta'ala has taken the pure matter of milk out of the impure matter of the cow, the animal, and presented it in pure form to the world. And Allah Ta'ala said that today, the analogy, the comparison, is the way Allah Ta'ala, in the way that Allah Ta'ala presents milk, it comes out through the impure matter of the cow, the animal, and given to us pure to drink. In the same way, my brothers, the analogy, the comparison here, is that if a person wants to be good and pure and sincere, Allah Ta'ala says, I send my Rijalullah, my walis, to the lands in the world. And our Hazrat Shaykh Sabd Ahmad Barakatum is walivala from those pious elders. He has come here, and through his being, his teaching, education, and his company, such youngsters and other people, and they've gone through and seen and experienced sin. Hazrat Shaykh's teaching has extracted them from the environment and purified them, made them clean and pure and sincere, and stood them up in front of us today. And that's what we learn from this verse. May Allah Ta'ala allow us to fulfill the haq, the rights of Hazrat Shaykh's teachings. Ameen. Hazrat, today I heard a further praise and introduction of Hazrat today, and I was swaying with happiness and I rejoiced. One of our brothers, I want to present and share a few words with you that I said a few days ago in Jummah as well, that if you hear the introduction and praise of someone and you don't appreciate and value, then you will lose that person's appreciation and value and their full effect. So we should understand the appreciation and value of Hazrat Shaykh Sahab. So our brother Suleiman Bhai Patel, who today has cooked the meal for the aqiqah of my son, and I invite all of you brothers that please partake of that meal before you depart after the gathering. So Suleiman Patel Bhai, he told me just recently that I have got a very good connection with Hazrat Shaykh from some time. And in time gone, Hazrat Shaykh Sahib used to sell clothes and shoes in his stores in the Arndale Centre in Manchester. And a person who was an assistant, a fellow shopkeeper, and he said these words, that one day I saw that Hazrat Shaykh Sahib was praying while the customer was waiting to buy the garment. And he said, I thought at that time, astaghfirullah, that how foolish can this be, that he's praying while the customer wants to buy? Why doesn't he sell the garment and then pray after? Then I, Suleiman Bhai, asked that shopkeeper, what happened then? Did he leave the shop of Hazrat Shaykh Sahib and come to you to buy the garment? He said, no, I used to sell the same garments, but the customer didn't come to me. He waited patiently. Hazrat Shaykh Sahib, Damat Barakatum, prayed, finished his prayer. Then the customer waited. Then he approached Hazrat Sahib and bought those garments and items, and he left the shop. My brothers, this shows Hazrat Shaykh Sahib wasn't there to sell the world and dunya. He was there to exchange the love, muhabbat, and the affection of the hearts. He was there to sell the love of the hearts, not to sell the dunya. He was there to exchange the love and muhabbat and tenderness of the heart. And we think otherwise today. So brothers, further I go, Hazrat Shaykh Sahib is a teacher and has connection with the Naqshbandi silsila, the Naqshbandi chain of teachers that goes back in history to Hazrat Abu Bakr Sadiq radiallahu anhu, the greatest Sahabi. And it started from there, the Naqshbandi silsila. And Hazrat Shaykh Jorunpuri rahmatullahi alayhi, damat barakatum, one of the great muhaddis of this day and age. Yes, and he's a muhaddith and a scholar, Shaykh al-Hadith, and he is a great and cautious scholar. And he has a very great status in ilm, and he's very cautious himself when he speaks about deen, ilm, and about other people. And he himself has said that the Naqshbandi silsila chain of sheikhs is very close, and its teaching and its effect is very close to the sunnah. The other silsilas, Chishtiya, Qadiriyya, Surwadi, are also close, but Naqshbandi chain of the teachers and the teaching is very close to the sunnah. And our own Shaykh, Hazrat Shaykh Sahib Ahmad Barakatum, is sitting here, has taught us that the special quality of Naqshbandi tariqah, over and above, it overwhelms the other silsilas. Because Qadri, Chishti, Surwardri silsilas, when a person, a student, takes bayah, pledges allegiance to a Shaykh in those three silsilas, and he starts to struggle and strive and do dhikr and work hard and improve himself, after quite some time, maybe some years, he makes effort, cleans his heart, he gets to the condition of jazb. And jizb is the sharia. What happens is that sharia marghubati tarbiyat, he comes to that condition, that situation, that after years maybe of struggling and striving, that it is becomes easy for him to practice sharia and sunnah. And even if a sin comes in front of him, he wants to sin, then it becomes difficult for him to sin, and it's easy for him to do amal on the deen. And that's called sharia marghubati tabiat. He comes to that station, and all with the fadl of Allah, the teaching of the muqabireen and the teachers, he gets to that station. And Hazrat Shaykh Sahib Damat Barakat has told us this is the situation of the other three silsilas. But our silsila, Naqshbandi silsila, which has a Shaykh Sahib himself teaches, Damat Barakatum, that where Chishtiya, Qadri, Surwardiya, where their teachings end, where their levels end, after years of struggling, that's where the Naqshbandi silsila starts. That's the initiation, first step, that when you take bayah and pledge allegiance to a Shaykh, like has a Shaykh Sahib, that is, you get jazb straight away, and you get the condition of nearness and love of the deen of Islam straight away, and you start to dislike sin straight away. May Allah Ta'ala allow us to benefit from the long age of our qabreen, Hazrat Shaykh Sahib Dama Barakatum, allow us to benefit straight away from the jizb. Now I won't speak too much more, and I don't want to take much more of your time up. I would like to invite Hazrat Shaykh Sahib Dama Barakatum that please come to us and speak and allow us to rectify our hearts.
Alhamdulillah, praise be to Allah. It is Allah's great, great mercy and favor upon us, who Allah Ta'ala has gathered us, assembled us, given us this opportunity that we individuals come together, sit together, talk about Allah, listen to things, good things about Allah, and remember Allah and do the dhikr of Allah. These gatherings, these assemblies are a great ihsan of Allah Ta'ala upon us, a great favor of Allah Ta'ala upon us, a great blessing of Allah Ta'ala upon us, was these gatherings, this mahfil of Allah Ta'ala's remembrance, where a person sits and gets together with other people and sits down and revises and goes through his life and goes through his situation and condition. And the pious predecessors and our elders, this is their methodology. Their objective is not to gather around for the sake of a big gathering for tafsir and commentary, but their original intention, their main purpose, is that we get together and there's somebody maybe who says a few words, and there are people who want to absorb the good words, and sometimes there are good people who don't want to absorb the words, they reject. Now, for example, when we were young, we went through the young life. We've forgotten that young life. And then when we went out of the age of being a child, we go into being youth. And the age of youth is for enjoyment and play and jest. And nobody wants to remember that time or to remember the important things. Then comes the teens, and after the teens, the middle ages, when a person's busy in the world. And then old age comes, and then he starts to think. And how can he think when he has forgotten everything? He keeps on forgetting. He keeps on forgetting the sabak, the lesson, the main point and objective of life. So the reality is that Allah Ta'ala's mercy, Allah Ta'ala has sent His blessings on such a person like me. And I had a passion and a desire to see this masjid, this mosque. And you can consider my maybe neglect or an inability that I didn't come here before, but the shock, the passion, the desire of Malana Sahab, they came, they met me, they requested, they used to give invites. Alhamdulillah, praise be to Allah, due to their love, their passion, their desire, their efforts, their struggling. And in the state of illness, Allah Ta'ala has dragged me here. So first and foremost, I will say with the depth of my heart that I'm very, very grateful to these brethren,
the intizamiya here, the leadership here, that they have given me the opportunity to come and sit with you, the opportunity to sit amongst friends and in this masjid, and to be able to put forward the discussion, and I've forgotten my weakness and neglect, and I've come here so we can all revise our life story. May Allah Ta'ala give them the highest ajr in this world and the hereafter. Ameen. So the sabak, we should never forget the lesson of life, the objective of life. We should continue to revise it daily, often, regularly. Allah has given us a message, خَلَقَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةَ لِيَبْلَوْكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. This is the sabak that we have to make strong. Allah Ta'ala said that your life, me and you, Allah Ta'ala has given us a life. Allah Ta'ala has given us a purpose. Allah Ta'ala has given us an objective. And that is a preparation. This life is a preparation. This life is not for eating. Yes, food is eaten and consumed to stay alive and live in this world. We shouldn't go further than that. So Allah Ta'ala has told us this, that this life I've given to you, it is preparation. So prepare in this world. For what? Allah Ta'ala says, لَنَبْلُوَلْنَكُمْ, Allah Ta'ala says. That Allah Ta'ala says, that after the preparation comes the exam, isn't it? That a student, he goes, he's reciting, he's going to school and he's preparing. And in our madrasas, mashallah, they make people prepare. And for what is he preparing? He knows that the test is going to come. The test is going to come, isn't it? So this is what's going to happen. Allah says after the year it comes, or after 6 months it comes. Allah Ta'ala said, I've not given no time for the exam. So you should be intelligent and ready in this preparation. The student, the 24 hours, 7 days a week, the student should be ready. His knowledge should be complete. And he shouldn't be lazy. Doesn't need to be forced to be ready. Everyone should be ready at any time for the examination. So Allah Ta'ala says that when the exam comes, when will it come? When will it come? It comes in the grave. You have to prepare in this world, above the earth, and the exam will come beneath the earth. Allah says that exam will come beneath the earth. So you will see sometimes, you read, you study, we all study. And we see how many kitabs you have to study to graduate. How many books you have to study to graduate and to go for the exam. And what is the question? There are 5-10 questions in the exam, isn't it? That's it. So Allah Ta'ala says that the preparation in this world, Allah has given us a big subject, أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. Allah Ta'ala says, this is the syllabus that I've given to you. Yes, that Allah Ta'ala said, in this world you have to prepare, and your syllabus أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا, Allah says. Yes, الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةَ لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. Allah says that your life should be based on good deeds, positive deeds, great deeds, beneficial deeds, so that they allow you to prepare. So what a great subject we've got. Allah Ta'ala said that what a big subject is Islam. حَقُوقُ الْعِبَادِ, حقوق الله, the rights of Allah, the rights of society, your house, environment, home, akhlaq, manners, so many subjects Allah Ta'ala has given to us. Allah Ta'ala said we have to prepare for the examination, which is after death, beneath in our grave. But we have to prepare on the earth while we're living, above the crust of the earth. And the question, Allah Ta'ala said that there are many subjects. And how many questions will there be in the exam? 3, 4, مَنْ رَبُّكَ, but there will be 3 for us. مَنْ رَبُّكُمْ, مَنْ دِينُكُمْ, مَنْ رَسُولُكُمْ. All of our preparation while we live in this world, and they will all come and be summarized in the 3 questions, مَنْ رَبُّكُمْ, مَنْ دِينُكُمْ, مَنْ رَسُولُكُمْ. And the individual who answers these 3 questions correctly in the exam, Allah will announce, you have passed, go. Success is yours. Success is yours. Allah Ta'ala has created life and death that He will try all of us who is best in conduct. When a child revises for an exam, then there are 2 types of students. One is the serious student who's revising, preparing. And the other people, they complain, oh, he's revising a lot, he's going to pass. So they start to disturb that student. Oh, why is he always studying? Why are you always studying? Look, there's a nice film that's on. Let's look at the film. Oh, they try to distract him. Oh, let's go and play some sports. Why are you revising? Why do you want to be a boffin? Come with us and study with and play with us. And they try to disturb him. So if he gets distracted, then his friends are in reality that his enemies. And when the result comes, that child cries, oh, if I didn't doss around with those people, if I didn't listen to their bad advice, if I'd saved myself from the company. Because the child doesn't listen at the time. The child who is easily led astray, he watches the films. But the child who's revising and who's stern, he forgets his films, he forgets playing. The other people are laughing at him and he's sitting in the corner revising, studying. Yes? Why?
So the people who disturbed the student destructed him, and he followed the destruction, then he will fail because he didn't prepare. So in this world the situation is the same, and the preparation for after death is the same for us. That when we start to journey and travel towards Allah, we start to revise, we start to go towards ibadah, worship, akhlaq, ibadah, the rights of society, our rights, families' rights, people's rights. When we get serious and start to travel on the path of the deen, what happens? The enemies surround us. They start to distract us. What are you doing? Oh, leave this world, is a place of enjoyment. You're stuck in Islam. Why are you practicing Islam? And they try to distract him, deviate him, take him off the tracks, off the path. May I give all my efforts for the sake of Allah Ta'ala's deen. Because when a human being is the enemy of another human being, it's very difficult. He's a hidden enemy. And he will attack you at any time. And you have to beware. You have to be careful and ready. Allah Ta'ala has sent His mercy on us, His fadl, His blessings, His bounty, His raham, His karam. That Allah Ta'ala has made apparent that enemy in front of us. It told us who is that enemy. Allah says, why? Because if you know who is your enemy, and you know who is going to attack you, who is going to kill you, what will you do? Always you will be shielding yourself, protecting yourself. You'll call police, there'll be surveillance, there'll be protection. And mostly what will you do? Worst case, what will you do? You say, okay, maybe he'll beat me and kill me. Okay, at least I'll reach to the other world. But the enemy of our life, the true life, the real enemy, listen carefully what I'm saying. This enemy, aduwwum mubeen, Allah Ta'ala says in the Quran, many places. Allah Ta'ala says, this enemy, he is your avowed enemy. He won't just destroy your life in this world. Rather, he will make such an enmity with you that until you, O insan, human being, are not dragged into the fire of Jahannam, this enemy of yours will not be happy, will not be content, will not sit back. And the loss of following this enemy is massive. If this enemy of yours deviates you and distracts you, it will take you far, far off the tracks. And the enemy of the world, worst case, he will kill you and you'll die in this world, but you'll get the reward in the hereafter, inshallah. But the enemy, your true avowed enemy, permanent enemy, he gets all of the satisfaction from your destruction. Not just on death, but in the hereafter. You will not get death, you will be given life and continuous adab a person will get. Continuous we will be burnt in Jahannam hellfire if we go into hellfire. Forever, forever. Just like the Quran says, the people, the inhabitants of Jahannam, they'll say, Allah kill us, Allah finish us. But Allah says, mouth will not come. Your life will be forever, the misery will be forever. And the people of hellfire will cry, Allah please let us die so we can end this misery of ours. Allah will say, no. So we need to revise, we need to prepare for the exam after death. Are we succeeding in the revision, or is our enemy who is distracting us, deviating us from revision and taking us off track from the syllabus, is he succeeding? Brothers, let's be clear, black and white, totally, the person who is following that syllabus, he is successful. He's successful. If we follow the syllabus of Allah, we are successful. When shaitan comes to deviate us, we shouldn't listen to one of his advices. Rather, we should go to ittiba'i Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, no, go away shaitan, we don't want your guidance. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is our guide. He has told us the haqq, the truth. And he tries his best, the insan, the human being, he tries his best to not listen to the enemy's advice. And he goes to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah says in the Quran, he is aduwwum mubeen, you're a cursed enemy. Now how much of a loss for us and a destruction. Allah has already told us who our enemy is. Our enemy is in front of us. And we don't protect ourselves. If we don't protect ourselves, then most definitely that enemy is with us side by side through our lives. He will never leave us and we will never be safe from him. And today we will realize who is protecting himself from shaitan, and the person who's not protecting himself from shaitan is living the life of deception. He's living the life of misguidance. A person who does not follow the formula of Allah Ta'ala of success in this world and hereafter, he is deviated off the tracks and he is living the life of craziness. We have to save ourselves from the enemy. How can I save myself from shaitan? Tell me. How can I? Big question. Big issue. Big issue. And this is a unique question. And where are you taking us? People must be thinking and saying to me today, why are you taking us towards Jahannam, the discussion of Jahannam? We are written, we're destined for paradise. And shaitan, how did he deviate us from paradise and take us towards Jahannam? And he's got weapons, he's got the tools, he's got the methods, he's got the strategy. So how do we save ourselves from shaitan? This is a very deep-rooted question. And very quickly, the questions will be asked us. Very quickly. Brothers, we see with our eyes regularly, daily. This is a beautiful, there's a website, an example somebody told me,
me. Every second that website it runs. And what is that website telling? This many people have died. This many people have died. This many people have died. There's a total record. Every second it updates the number of deaths of people around us in the world. That site, it is continuing. The iterations are continuing. The updates are continuing. And the numbers and the figures are updating. And our name will also be added to this list. How a person, he sits and stands and walks around, things are not going to die. Just like the raindrops drop onto the earth from the skies, in the same way people are dying. Their bodies are being shrouded with the kafan, their janazah is prayed, and they are taken to their grave in the Qabristan. And the same thing will happen to us. But we have a syllabus to follow in this world. Are we following that syllabus? Are we protecting our iman? Are we traveling towards success in the hereafter? Big question, big answers are required. Ask yourself this in your heart today. If you're not protecting your iman today, then we are living the big life of deception. I may think I'm living the life of Deen Islam, but I'm not following Deen. I'm not following Islam. Then what will happen? But yes, if I continue to follow the guidance set down by Allah, then I am hopeful. Then we are hopeful that we cannot be deviated by the enemy. So first point is now today Allah Ta'ala has announced and reminded us who is our enemy, Shaitan. So what do we have to do? Protect ourselves from our enemy of Shaitan. Guard ourselves. Allah Ta'ala loves His creation, His servant. Allah is Kareem, Ghaffar, Sattar. He has got all these blessings and mercies around us. Allah said, look, I told you who's your enemy. I told you his tricks and games. And I'll tell you how to protect yourselves. If we don't protect ourselves now, what a big loss. Will we protect ourselves? Say, inshallah, inshallah. Allah says in the Quran, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu dhkurullah. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu dhkurullah. O you who believe, I tell you the protection from the cursed shaitan. What action should you do to protect yourself, shield yourself from shaitan? There's no action that can save you. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu dhkurullah. O you who believe, there's no other action that can save you from shaitan, shield you from shaitan. Allah says, O my believers, I love you. And to save you from shaitan, I've given you such a weapon, such a tool, the dhikr of Allah. The dhikr of Allah. Allah says, my remembrance will shield you and hide you from shaitan. Wahid, only one action, the dhikr of Allah, the remembrance of Allah can save you from shaitan, from the devil. There's no other action that can save you from shaitan. In Sahih al-Bukhari, there's a hadith. Hazrat Ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhu, Hazrat Abdullah Ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhu, may Allah be pleased with him, said that the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to us that shaitan, he is stuck to your heart. The shaitan, he is stuck like a wasp when he stings. The shaitan is stuck to your heart. Allah Ta'ala scanned our hearts and told us clearly. Like, you know, you do the x-ray, you see all the deficiencies within the body. Allah says, there's no bigger information than this. I'm telling you, Allah says, I've done your x-ray for you already. The scan has been done. The MRI scans will be done. The shaitan is stuck, super glued to your heart. Like he's biting your heart. And nothing can remove the shaitan who's stuck to your heart. Nothing. And what does shaitan do then? The words of the hadith. He is stuck to your heart, clinging to your heart. Grabbing to your heart. And he's attacking you. Attacking you. Like, you know, when something like an insect is stuck to something and it bites that thing. Same way shaitan attacks. And he's trying to inject into us a 99.9%. Of the time, the reason for our destruction and loss and negativity in life is due to this point. Shaitan, he takes us away from iman. Shaitan takes us away from salah. Shaitan takes us towards the big sins and all the sins. And shaitan comes into our hearts and instills bad thoughts, evil thoughts, ajib wasawis, ajib whispering in our ears and our hearts. He instills and creates bad thoughts, bad inclinations, bad feelings, and depression. That's also from shaitan. Every single loss and negativity, thoughts, emotions of the world, you name them today, whatever's present in our minds and hearts, all of that emanates from shaitan. Shaitan, Allah Ta'ala says, but the person who is neglectful of my dhikr, then shaitan, he is stuck to that person's heart. The person who is neglectful of Allah Ta'ala's dhikr. Doesn't matter how many cures we go towards, depression, doctor, injections, tranquilizers, tablets, or mental hospitals, or around our necks, you can get taweez, put them around the necks of your children. Do what you want and may, but you cannot get the cure unless you run to the cure of Allah. You cannot get the cure that Allah Ta'ala has set aside for us. You cannot start to pray salah. You will not become a pious servant of Allah. That subject Allah Ta'ala has given to us, if you do not, you will not be able to follow the syllabus of life. Dhikr of Allah is the great action, a great, great cure. And if you implement dhikr of Allah, your whole life in this world and the hereafter, you will attain the qurb, the nearness of Allah through the dhikr of Allah. How can you leave? How can I leave the dhikr of Allah? Amazing thing. Pick up the history of our pious predecessors, our akabirin. Dhikr, how much did they do dhikr? They lived, breathed dhikr. In my lives, I've seen some walis of Allah. My own Shaykh Hazrat Nur Allah Marqada Rahmatullah, when he used to do dhikr, his tongue was moist with the dhikr of Allah. Moist, wet with the dhikr of Allah. He was a wali. Dhikr of Allah, regular. As a Junaid Baghdadi Rahmatullah, he went to a barber. And the barber who used to trim the moustache, and his lips were quivering. And the barber said, please, Sheikh, can you just stop your lip for a while so I can trim the moustache, otherwise I'll cut the lip. He said, if you cut my lip, you might cut my neck, but my tongue cannot stop dhikr of Allah. You're asking me to stop moving my lips? And we think we are the rightful owners of Jannah, but we are sinning. X, Y, Z, left, right, back and forth. We have friendship with shaitan, we do tawbah, repent, then we break the tawbah. And I have the desire in my heart, I want to be saved. Man, woman, old, young, all of us want to be saved. But as long as we have dunya in our hearts, we cannot attain Allah. We cannot attain Allah. My friends, dunya, we should have dunya. An attachment to dunya, as much as we need it, and only proportionate to the amount we need it, which is very minuscule. But not more than that. But the reason for our destruction and loss today and losing the game is where shaitan is stuck on our hearts, he's whispering in our hearts, in our minds, and we are destroyed. May Allah not be happen. Our young child life went, young life went, teens went, middle age went, now we're in the old age. If this goes, then take heed. Most definitely, these questions will not be easy in the grave. They will be very hard. This is a very difficult examination, my brothers. We have the theory. We studied the theory. We know the exam questions. We've got the mock papers. We know the questions and answers. But when the questions in reality ask us on exam day, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu dhkurullah, Allah Ta'ala says, do my dhikr. Remember me now, so you remember the answers on that day. Because when you do the dhikr of Allah in this world, then shaitan scarpers. Shaitan scarpers, he's stuck to your heart soon as you start dhikr of Allah. This is Sahih Hadith, shaitan scarpers. He runs away. Another hadith, it is stated that the difference between the people who are alive and dead, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave us the example. That when shaitan is attached to the heart, when you do dhikr, he scarpers, he detaches himself and runs away, and you get a new life, a new lease of life. When you start to do dhikr, you feel a fresh new lease of life. A change comes into your mind, your brain, your heart, your body feels fresh, you feel light. That person who does dhikr of Allah, his heart is alive and his body is alive. And the person who doesn't do dhikr of life, his heart is dead and he's dead. How can he be alive? Animals eat, birds eat, donkeys eat, dogs eat, cats eat. So if we think we are superior and we're eating and drinking, that's not life. Life is when the heart is alive, when you recognize your Lord. By dhikr of Allah. Our maqam is nearness to Allah. Irfani ilahi. This is a maqam. Allah has given us such ibadah worship. Such ibadah worship that when we prostrate, then Allah should be in our sights. This is our basis of ibadah, of worship. Tajalliyat. The Kaaba, when we go around the Kaaba, we don't go around the Kaaba for physically going around the Kaaba. The elders in Islam, when they sit in front of the Kaaba, the pious predecessors, they see the vision of the tajalliyat of Allah descending from the heavens onto the Kaaba. Our maqsad, whatever ibadah Allah Ta'ala has given us, worship, it takes us to the nth degree, because Allah Ta'ala has made one maqsood. The maqsad of your dhikr and remembering me is to attain my marifah and nearness. Allah says, you come here for salah, you think you prayed salah, that's it? That's not it. That's not the objective. You've kept the fast, or I've kept the fast, that's it. Is the reality just fasting physically and staying hungry and thirsty? Allah says, no. Come to the reality, haqiqat, the end point. You've done hajj. Ya hajj upon hajj upon hajj. You went to Arafat, hundreds of thousands. Allah says, show me one haji who has reached to the reality of hajj. Hajj mabrur. Who has attained my irfan. Who has attained my nearness. People, they are going home with the dates and the zamzam. But show me the haji, Allah says, who's going back home to his country, who has left with my ma'rifat. With my nearness, with my qurb. When he's leaving Allah's home, he's crying, the tears, my love, my detachment is paining him. He's shunned the dunya and left. And when he came, the dunya was attached to his heart. And when you come to Arafat, then this is the true hajj reality, that you leave everything of the dunya there, and you depart from Arafat, go back home with the marifat, the love, the nearness, the qurb of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the name, the definition of hajji. The dunya people call you hajji, but in the book of Allah you are written as hajji, if you do the true tawbah. Such a great insan, because why are we not what we should be today? We have forgotten our lesson, our objective, our syllabus of Islam. The enemy is distracting us, deviating us, and Allah says, you don't realize. So, my friends, Allah Ta'ala says, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu dhkuru Allaha dhikran kathira. Allah has given order to the people of man, do my dhikr, Allah says. If you do dhikr, shaitan runs off.
So this is the praise of dhikr in another hadith in Fazail-e Amal, as a Shaykh Ladis has written, Rahmatullah Umar Asala, that they used, himself he used to do dhikr. He himself used to do dhikr. When a person enjoys something, he does that action. If you ask someone, what have you cooked today? Or I've cooked this today. Why did you cook this today? Because I liked it, I wanted it, I felt like eating this. So a person doesn't start sitting and writing kitabs. He writes about those subjects that he himself likes. And he has taste and enjoyment. Today when we read the hadith in Fazail-e Amal, our jamaats, hundreds of thousands of millions read these kitab, Fazail-e Amal. Why don't they read any other kitab? Those same hadith are present in other kitabs, aren't they? Why do they read Fazail-e Amal? Because that kitab that was written with a trace, with a methodology that I have felt this, I have done this, and I'm writing this. He, Hazrat Shaykhul Hadith, Alhamdulillah, wrote his experiences, just like you have cookbooks, cookery books, I write a book, put this many teaspoons of this garlic and sauce and haldi. If I don't write how much they should put, then they will get ill, get diarrhea and go to the doctors. And then my book will be shunned. So the chef, who is a good chef, he knows how to cook. When he starts to write a good cookery book, his book will sell and spread. Because people didn't have the taste before. They followed his direction, followed his ingredients and recipes. And then he'll give the same taste to everybody else. As a Shaykh Ladis, rahimahullah ta'ala, he knew the taste of doing dhikr of Allah. What is the taste? That's why, subhanAllah, Hazrat Shaykh Ladis did this work voluntarily for the sake of Allah. When they raise their pens, they don't write their books for selling the books, making money and wealth. How many hundreds of thousands of prints and copies of this book are in the people's homes? And we're not enjoying life until we don't see that kitab in the morning. Why? Because that book is full of ruhaniyat, light, illumination. With the fadl of Allah, that kitab has been written. I tell you, that pen was full of nur, and that book was written with nur, and that is spiritual food that has been cooked before us, left for us to consume. And we are being fed this spiritual food of Fazail-e Amal when we read the hadith. When I look here, where do I read from? The hadith of dhikr in Fazail-e Amal, the taste of those hadith is so unique. SubhanAllah. So these are words of experience, alhamdulillah. So I'm talking about dhikr of Allah. And Hazrat Shaykh Ladis said this in that dhikr of Allah, we have to be safe from the enemy, shaitan. Do you want to be safe from shaitan? Are you sleeping or are you listening? You come from far. Are you listening to what I'm saying? MashaAllah, then listen carefully. That if you want to be safe from shaitan, what a beautiful thing, Hazrat Shaykh Ladis said in Fazail-e Amal, Hazrat Shaykh Ladis said that dhikr of Allah is a fort. It is like a castle. If you do dhikr of Allah, it will become a castle for you. And you will be in that castle and shaitan will be trapped outside, gone far away. And he will run far away. And people, can they break the castle, the walls of the fort? No, because this is the fort that Allah Ta'ala has constructed. The construction of the fort of La ilaha illallah, made by Allah, nobody can break it. Shaitan cannot break through the walls. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu dhkurullaha dhikran kathira. Allah Ta'ala says, that do dhikr, but remember one point, what do you do? How much dhikr should you do? Kathiran kathira, because this enemy of yours is great. Great in the sense he's very strong and powerful. He's not a good enemy, he's strong and powerful. So don't just do dhikr 2, 3, 4 minutes. Do dhikr kathiran kathira. And here the pious predecessors and commentary, is kathiran kathira abundance 20,000, 30,000, 40,000 tasbih? No. Kathiran in abundance, high quantity, is a very simple formula. We think kathiran means lots of dhikr, I have to spend hours, it's a struggle and I'll fall down and stumble. No. I will tell you, will you learn? Then I'll tell you. Will you learn? You'll have to learn, then I will tell you this formula. We are sitting here, we sit with the tasbih and think we're doing 10,000, 15,000, 20,000. This is not kathiran kathiran. This is not dhikr in abundance. Doesn't matter how much you do. Doesn't matter how much you do. So what is dhikr kathiran kathira in high quantity, high numbers? The pious predecessors say the definition of kathiran kathira is that when you do dhikr kathiran kathira, there should be no limit, unlimited, and it's very easy to do that. So kathir, dhikr, the definition is the dhikr of the heart, not from the tongue. The dhikr of the heart. When you do dhikr from the heart, that is the definition of dhikr kathiran kathira. Remember this. Remember this. Dhikr of the heart is the original dhikr. And the dhikr of the tongue is called tasbih dhikr. Your tongue will get tired, but the heart never tires. Because the function of the heart, the production of the heart was for this reason. The heart says, give me more. Give me more. You sleep and I'll carry on beating. You sleep, and who stops me, says the heart. You are tired, your eyes are tired, your hands are tired, your feet are tired, your body is tired, your limbs are tired, your organs are tired. But the heart says, why should I tire? I was created, manufactured for the name of Allah. You sleep, O man, and let me continue doing my function, objective. There was an individual came to me. I remember a point, beautiful old event. A brother came to me from Africa. From Africa. He said, what is this dhikr? Dhikr-e-khafi, old event. I said, dhikr?
He said, what is dhikr of the qalb? I've never heard of dhikr qalb, of the heart. Is this dhikr? You sit down, you close the eyes, and you concentrate on the heart. What's the faida, the benefit? You don't speak, you don't recite, I don't understand. What are you doing? I said, look brother, if I start speaking, I thought, Allah, what tafsir shall I give to this person with this regard? I said, learn this dhikr, you've come from so far, inshallah, you will realize this is good dhikr. No, okay, I've come, teach me then, fine, teach me dhikr. Then I taught him the dhikr of the heart on his heart, and then he went to sleep. Then when he slept and lied down, he told me himself, I didn't know. He said that when I went to the right, the wall said, Allah, Allah, Allah. He said, I thought this is deception. He said, I went to the other side left, I looked towards the ceiling, Allah, Allah, Allah. And he said, my heart was beating. He said, I went to the left, looked to the wall on the left. And he said, I heard the words, Allah, Allah, Allah. He said, Hazrat, all my night I couldn't sleep. My heart was alive. I said, I told you before, this dhikr is not the dhikr of the tongue. It's a great dhikr, it's high volume. Kathir and kathir in the heart. The heart speaks. And we are sleeping, that's different. But the heart speaks, it is alive. And it speaks itself. Allah Ta'ala, it remembers Allah so much. So the heart, kathir, Allah says in the Quran, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu dhkuru Allah dhikran kathira. What is that dhikr? It is the dhikr, say it loudly, the dhikr of the heart. So after today, drop your tasbihs and take the dhikr of the heart. That's it. Allah's order has come. Otherwise shaitan will not die. Tomorrow you can't make excuses, Allah, what should we do? Shaitan was big, he was powerful. I did dhikr with the tasbih. I did three tasbihs and this. Allah says, I told you kathir. Do dhikr kathir. Did you do dhikr of the heart? No, Allah, I was ashamed. Hazrat Sahib came to our mosque, but people were looking at me. I was ashamed. How can I learn the dhikr? No. I was a big man, big status, and I learned zikr in front of Shaykh Sahib, in front of other people, and they will say to me, I'm mad as well, and I was ashamed. See? This is the game of shaitan. He's stopping us. He is killing off our sabak. Hey, you have to become a mujahid. Doesn't matter what happens, I'm nothing. Today we will realize, alhamdulillah, I was going towards destruction. The dhikr I thought was dhikr, and I was not going towards that. That was the initiation. The tasbih zikr is initiation, the first steps. Dhikr of the heart is kathir and kathira. Tell me, how did Hazrat, how do I do dhikr, kathir and kathira? Then we know we've come to Masjid Noor, and there's noor. There's light. I will say this, so brothers, mashallah, if some people have become, learn it today, that's the maza, the enjoyment of today's gathering. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu dhkuru Allah dhikran kathira, Allah says. Let's go forward. Allah Ta'ala goes further, Allah is telling us beautiful things. Wasabihu wahu bukratun wa asila, Allah Ta'ala says. Subhanallah. That look, listen here, what did I say, Allah says? Enemy. The enemy, Allah Ta'ala says, I gave the enemy a tool, a weapon, and I told you the solution, how to ward him off, how to attack him with dhikr. And Allah says, on which maqam you can attack him, how? There are two times Allah Ta'ala selected for dhikr. Allah says, bukratan wa asila, the morning and the evening. Allah says, I've selected bukratan wa asila, morning and evening. Allah Ta'ala has not named anything else, zuhr, salah, or other times. There are many times in the day with blessings. Allah said, morning and evening. There's a big maslah here. Allah Ta'ala is Rahim and Kareem, and He is the one who has given us the knowledge. Allah Ta'ala said, I've given you the times, the morning and the evening. These are the two times between which you need to do dhikr of Allah. Allah Ta'ala says that these are the dangerous times, the morning and the evening. When the morning, Allah Ta'ala says, when you hear Hayya ala Salah, it is difficult for us to get up from the bed, and shaitan comes and he keeps on making us sleep. And subhanAllah, the hadith states that the urine drops on his face due to listening to the order of shaitan. And every day this game is being played. May Allah Ta'ala give us such a way that we know that people in the morning, they've left the salah. Allah Ta'ala says that, subhanAllah, that how many people who with iman on their face, shaitan urinates on their face and departs. Of people who on face, the man and the woman, it doesn't matter how much makeup she puts on her face. But there is such a ugliness on the face of that woman, doesn't matter how much you adorn your face with the creams and the beautification and all of the face washes. But my friends, when a person is seen like that, who the shaitan has urinated on his face, then the eyes are dropped because shaitan has urinated on his face. Never think, who has done this? Who has left? Allah Ta'ala says, this is not the taqaz of iman. The shaitan, he comes to you, he says, sleep, sleep, sleep. Don't go towards dhikr of Allah, fajr prayer. Pray from tomorrow, start from tomorrow. He gives you excuses. And Allah says in the hadith, the excuses are there. There are ways, there are reasons. You have to ask that, which reason can I leave salah in jamaat and congregation? Which sharia excuse? What reason? I have to go work? Do I leave salah? Or I have to do this action? Or I have to drive the taxi? Doesn't matter, I pray at home? Don't go to the masjid? Are these the excuses? Never can it be. Allah Ta'ala's syllabus is present in sharia. The law is present. present in Sharia. The fuqaha, the jurists, the imams who were born, the four imams, the mujtahideen, they were created for this reason, that they disseminated, distributed, and taught us the ilm for today. And all of the laws are there, that you have to pray in this way, because if you don't pray salah in congregation when you should pray, be prepared, the shaitan will urinate on your face, and when the shaitan urinates on your face, will you be able to give the answers in the grave? And when the angels come to you to see you in the grave, they will have their faces covered, because of the stench and the smell of the urine. This is a stench from his face. And people think that they have a bath in the world with shampoo, facial wash, and body wash, and perfumes, and fragrance. We go out in the world, but your grave will be full of the stink, the smell, because you never prayed. So the morning time and the evening time. Allah says that the morning time, all of the efforts of shaitan, he makes in the morning and in the evening. Because he makes big effort on the insan. Allah says, don't send your children out. This hadith of Rasulullah, don't send your children out at dusk before sunset. All of the fitnas come out. All of shaitans come out. All of the works of shaitan come out. All of the fitna and the haram starts after the evening. In the houses and the outside parties, functions, events, and haram actions. When do they occur? In the evening. Mostly the time of neglect and loss and destruction. Allah says the shaitan attacks people. When does he play with human beings? When he makes them wretched and zaleel, and gives them such a bad condition and consequence. Allah says, this is the time. So that's why Allah says, bukratan wa asila, never reject and neglect and leave the dhikr in the morning and the evening. Remember this. Yes, and this is bukratan wa asila, from morning and the evening. 30, 40 years, I never saw my sheikh, my teacher, that the maraqbah of the morning or evening, ever did he leave it. I've never seen in my life my sheikh, my teacher in his company, and other pious predecessors, other elders. That was their ma'amool. When they prayed fajr, after fajr they had one function, la ilaha illallah. Hazrat sheikh, my sheikh, his majlis gathering was big, massive. Even the cleaners outside, they're washing the clothes, la ilaha illallah, la ilaha illallah. The dhikr reached to them. This was that generation of Deoband, such a great generation, that from the muhtamam, from the teacher, the principal of Deoband, to the cleaner, to the worker, all of them were students of dhikr, and they did dhikr. And these were akabreen who loved dhikr so much. And we say today is bidah, innovation, and take dhikr out of the masjid. Don't teach it in the masjid. Imagine, do justice. Allah says, fill up the masjid with my dhikr. And we say, take the dhikr out of the masjid. Is bidah, innovation, people with sense and ilm. Because when shaitan plays his tricks and games, then knowledge will not save you. Imam Razi, rahmatullah, have you heard his event? He was dying. What was his situation at death? Shaitan attacked him. How shall I be saved? How shall I be saved? Then he paid attention to his sheikh. His sheikh said, give these answers to shaitan, you'll be saved. So his sheikh did tawajjuh on him. Tasawwuf is haq. So shaitan has been given all the tools by Allah. All the tools. If you can be saved, you can only be saved by that tool in which Allah Ta'ala has kept the cure from shaitan. Shaitan, doesn't matter how much strength he has, and he comes to you to attack you. Doesn't matter if you are there in the biggest of gathering, even if the most beautiful woman has come and sat in front of you naked, and you're in isolation, and dhikr starts, you will not realize where is that haram that was in front of you. You will not realize. I say by Allah, say the name of Allah once, all of the walls will shake and crumble and fall to dust. Everything. What is jinn? What is shaitan? Today we run around to the black magic people, the jinn, I've got problems, issues. Why? Because shaitan is free. He has stuck himself to your heart. He's made you his worker. Then what's going to black magic people? They're earning money. Because stop going to the amil, and Allah Ta'ala, shaitan says, you work and I'll give you the money. Half is yours, half is mine. And they're working 50-50 basis profit. The black magic, the sorcerer, the exorcist, he's doing his work with shaitan, half. May Allah not bring this to us, this destruction. Allah Ta'ala, what's happening today in the world? Why have we given all of our strength away to the opposition? Recognize the loss we're in. There's a big line. People, good people, with knowledge and ilm and aql and intellect, but nobody wants to listen to Allah. Allah says in the Quran, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu. Allah says, look what is Allah saying. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu dhkurullaha. Amanu dhkurullaha dhikran kathira. Allah says clearly in the Quran, oh my servants, do dhikr of Allah. Do dhikr of Allah, my servants. I'm telling you with love. I love you, Allah says. Do dhikr kathiran kathira. In abundance and high quantity. And what else does Allah say? Allah says, do it, صَبَّهُهُ بُكْرَةً وَأَسِيلًا. Allah Ta'ala says, do my dhikr every day in morning and do it in the evening. Allah says, I'm giving you the formula. I'm saving you from shaitan. And when you finish by doing the dhikr, Allah says, Allahu Akbar, you listened to me in the morning. You did my dhikr in the morning. And you stood up, you get the reward of one hajj and one umrah. Thawab. Accepted, maqbool. Allahu Akbar, glad tidings to a person who's done all of his amal in the world, in his life, and he goes to his qabr. He's got hajj and umrah. He never went to Makkah. He never got to Medina. In the morning, they did dhikr of Allah every day. And when they got up from dhikr, 80, 90 years of age, how many hajj and how many umrahs they earned in their life? Because they stayed in dhikr after fajr till sunrise. Prepare today, we are ill. We are sitting, children, old people, young people. Allah is Rahim. I swear by Allah. If today with a true heart you say, Allah, that from today I will do this amal. But doctors say you will not be cured today. You are about to die. And you are sent to the gathering of dhikr. My brothers, I swear by Allah Rabbul Izzat that today if you make the intention and you come and learn the dhikr from me and say I will do this amal in my life, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I am hopeful with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inshallah, your whole previous life, decades, you will get the rewards of all those mornings that you wasted as well. I swear, because Allah is Rahim, Allah is Kareem, He is Ghaffar. Makammal, totally, He wants to save us from Jahannam. If today you are astray, Allah says, don't worry. If you understand what I'm saying today, my son, if today you hear the message, Allah says, I accept you are negligent, you are sinner. If today you listen to me, Allah says, all the moments you wasted in your life, today you start from tomorrow, sit in dhikr until Ishraq. Allah says, I'll give you all of what you wasted before the days. Do you want to give a bargain today to Allah? Do you want to make this transaction, this sale with Allah, O young person, O old person? Do you want to revive your life? Do you want to revive your qabr, your grave? Or do you want to leave this gathering, go empty-handed to the grave and say, oh, my friends, my brothers, this is an enlightened gathering. How could I come here? Dear? How, Manchester, how could I have come to this Masjid al-Nur? Such a great Masjid, Allah's fazl and karam, He's allowed me to come and sit. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu dhkurullaha dhikran kathira wa sabibuhu wa bukratan wa asila. Then Allah Ta'ala continues that when a person sits in dhikr, one hajj and one umrah thawab. هو الذي يصلي عليكم وملائكته. That when you do dhikr, my remembrance in the gathering, in isolation, on your own, in darkness, in a gathering, in light, in the shopping center, in your car, in the world, in the plane, wherever you do my dhikr, هُوَ الَّذِي يُسَلِّي عَلَيْكُمْ وَمَلَائِكَتُهُ. Allah says, your Rabb is with you. My angels are with you. In the heavens, the light, the enlightened creation of the world. Allah says, you don't have the accountants. To see of their number, the angels that are circumambulating around the Kaaba, rotating around the Kaaba, in the world their duties, Allah has given to the millions and billions of angels. Who will let you sleep? When Allah sends the mercies, then which angel will dare not to do dua for you, O individual? Tell me. هو الذي يصلي عليكم وملائكته. Allah says, me and all of my billions of angels, trillions, the number is infinite. They send rahmah and du'as for you. That individual, you, us today sitting here, we are immersed maybe in shirk, bid'at, innovation, partners with Allah, alcohol, immersed in zina, opposite sex is mingling. When he starts to do dhikr, he is saying to Allah, Allah, I'm doing the dhikr. Allah says, me and my angels start to send their rahmah towards you. يصلي عليكم وملائكته. Aha, subhanallah. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu dhkuru Allaha dhikran kathira wasabbihuhu wa bukratan wa asila. Huwa alladhi yusalli alaykum wa malaikatahu liyukhrijahukum min adh-dhulumati ila an-nur. Liyukhrijahum min adh-dhulumati ila an-nur. Allah Ta'ala says, I take him, yukhrij, out of, extract the persons immersed in the sins, in darkness. May Allah forgive that we do such sins, that if those sins were made apparent, I tell you, brothers, these walls would shake. These walls would shake. Shaitan makes us do such sins in the darkness. We do such weird, such unique sins. We have Quran in our hearts, we do sins. We have the prostration mark on our foreheads, we do sins. We are going around the Kaaba in tawaf, we're doing sins. Allahu Akbar. When insan drops, he drops to the bottom of the drain, into the depths of the darkness. Then shaitan, forget shaitan, even the jinnat, they're embarrassed that this person's gone that low. He starts to do zina with the daughters, with the mothers. Zina. I am not saying some stories, I'm telling you the truth. Because this can happen. Why? Because the power of sin, it makes him do whatever can be done in the darkness of the night. Why did you do zina with your sister? Why did you do? It was the middle of the night and there was haram and the electricity was off and we were sitting there and we could see things and shaitan came in between us and he forgets he's his sister, his brother, and zina occurred. Astaghfirullah. The lands, they shook. The earth, it shook. Allahu Akbar. Allah is so merciful. Allah is so merciful. Allah has got the power of rahmat that after a long time a person he gets the tawbah. After a long time. When insan does good deeds, Allah Ta'ala makes it apparent. Subhanallah. Allah makes it, when a person does a sin, Allah puts the veils on his sins. Allah says to the angels, wait, be patient, my servant will come. He will come back. Be patient. I am the Rabb. This is my servant. Why do you, O angels, want to give him punishment? He will come. Wait, don't complain. And maybe today, such a sinner like me today, sitting and does tawbah and stands and leaves this gathering. And maybe I'll be successful. Maybe. Look. It's important. يُخْرِجُ مِنَ الظُّلُمَاتِ إِلَى النُّورِ Allah says, when he does dhikr, Allah says, what happens? Then he comes to Allah Ta'ala. Allah Ta'ala's nur and marifat and nearness and qurb, he is immersed in the same sinner who is in the darkness of sins and haram. He starts to do Allah's dhikr. He dives into the pool of Allah's qurb and nearness. Allah says, وَكَانَ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَحِيمًا Subhanallah. He says, this is the reason. That what should I do? Allah says, I love the people of Iman so much. Allah says that I love them so much when they are corrected, when they come to Tawbah. Allah says, I feel like so much to give them their rewards. In Tafsir al-Rahmani, a certain Tafsir, it has been written, why is Rahim been written? Bil mu'mineen al-Rahim. In the Tafsir it is written that Allah is Rahman, but Allah is Rahim also. And there's a difference here. In the tafsir it is stated, beautiful point here, that from Rahim Allah Ta'ala also gives fazl. And also from Rahim Allah Ta'ala gives the Rahmah. But the difference here is that Allah Ta'ala says from Rahman, it could be like it is a bitter medicine and Rahim is a sweet tasting medicine. That is why Allah is Rahman, Allahu Akbar, Allah is Rahman and Rahim. Allah says, يُخْرِجُهُمْ مِنَ الظُّلُمَاتِ إِلَى النُّورِ Subhanallah. So Allah says, I give khas Rahmah. Allahu Akbar, Allah says, then Allah gives His salam to the people. And Allah says, in the dunya everything's for you. And when you come to me, and when we meet on the day, Allah says, then how will I meet the people of dhikr? How will I meet them? Allahu Akbar. هو الذي يصلي عليكم والملائكة يخرجكم من الظلمات إلى النور وكان بالمؤمنين رحيما. And then further Allah says, salam. My Hazrat used to say beautifully, Allah said, look here. That the people who do dhikr, a beautiful, glad, good piece of news has come to them. What? That Allah says to everyone, that however you want, but the dhakir, how will I see him? Allah says, with salam and kalam, with my salam and with speech I will meet them. Allahu Akbar. So Allah says, what does this mean? With the gift, Allah says. Allah will give the gift. Hadiya, Allahu Akbar. Imagine, what is dhikr? Subhanallah. Allah says that this is such a great ibadah. Allah says, I'll give you the gift, that when the people of the world, they will be so distressed and they will get the rewards of zikr. And what gifts will they get? Salam. Allah says, I'll give you salam. Allah says, it's me who blesses you and my angels, and I'll take you out of darkness into light. And your salutation on the day when you will meet me, peace. Will you promise that after today you will learn dhikr? If you promise, raise your hands, you will learn dhikr. MashaAllah, you've understood. Masjid Noor. MashaAllah, it looks like there's Noor in this masjid. You understand quickly. You realize quickly. Tayyatum Allah Ta'ala says, Allahu Akbar. Allah gives a promise here. That Allah Ta'ala says, Wa'adda lahum. Allahu Akbar. Allah is giving the messages. SubhanAllah, this verse of the Quran, it states here, Allah says that tahiyyatuhum yawma yalqawnahu salamun wa a'adda lahum ajran kareema. Allah says that my salutation to you on the day, I will meet you and I will say peace, salam, and I've prepared for you a goodly recompense. Then Allah Ta'ala says, first I will give you ajr. Allahu Akbar. The Allah says, Ya ayyuha nabiyyu inna arsalnaka shahidan wa mubashshiran wa nadira. The Allah says, I'll give you ajr. I'll give you great, great kareem, Allah says. Wa a'adda lahum ajran kareem. SubhanAllah, this ajiz is telling you this. Ajr, Allah says, and I will give you ajr kareem, a reward. So what Allah prepared? We are dhakirin. We go to thereafter, inshallah, you will go to thereafter. You are a dhakir. You've remembered Allah. You've done dhikr of Allah. And Allah says, that first, on the day of judgment, first, tahiyyatuhum yawma yalqawnahu salam. I give you salutation on that. My salutation will be salam. And further, وَعَدَّ لَهُمْ عَجْرًا كَرِيمًا Allah says, I will give you Jannah, but a special Jannah. This Jannah will be full of common things. But in this Jannah, special Jannah for the Dhakreen, what will be the speciality in there? That will be the sight, the vision of Allah. Aha. Allah says, I'll give you, I will have prepared for you a goodly recompense, the sight of mine you will see. So will you do dhikr? No, because this is the special gift for those people in the rafta and special rank of Jannah, the sight of Allah. We will not get the opportunity after it. Hazrat Abu Sayyid radiallahu anhu, he narrates in a hadith that the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was asked, O Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, on the day of judgment. Listen to this hadith clearly.
Listen clearly. Who will be the greatest people? Who will be the highest people? The best people on the Day of Judgment? What a great question. The Sahaba Ikram, they would have shaken when they had this question. The question and the answer is going to come. That on the Day of Judgment, O Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, who will be the greatest and best of people? The Sahaba asked this, what was their purpose? That whatever the answer will come from Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, we will bring into our lives. And today you also promised the answer that came from who? The head of the prophets, Imamul Anbiya, Makinat Ghumbat-e-Khizra, the inhabitant of Ghumbat-e-Khizra of Madinatul Manawara, Sayyidul Awwal Wa-Akhirin, who is the bride of Subhanallah, the mercy of the universe, Imamul Anbiya al-Mursaleen, Rahmatul lil Alameen, the mercy to the universe, Mahabubur Rabbul Alameen, Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is given the answer. Who was asked this question? What a beautiful answer he must give, and he gave the answer in two words. So you can do this quickly. Who is the best? As Abu Sa'id Khudri asked, who is the best and greatest person on the Day of Judgment, O Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam replied, the best is the person, the man and woman who did the most dhikr, the dhakireen in abundance. May Allah Ta'ala give me and you the tawfiq to do the dhikr of Allah. A few broken words are presented to you with the fadl of dhikr. I ask and seek forgiveness that I took up your time. In reality, I did not come here to listen or to speak. First, I was given the opportunity to listen in the beginning, and I spoke also. So I came here rather to do amal, to practice. And now there's tight time to practice, and this is the problem. So what should we do? Doesn't matter. Okay, 5-10 minutes. I'll ask as a loan from the people of the masjid that can you give us a loan of 5-10 minutes into Isha time? Inshallah, Allah will give you the reward in the hereafter. So please give us 5 or 10 minutes extra for implementing. Yes? No, please, I don't want to give pain or issues to the musallis in the area. Inshallah. So inshallah, Isha will take place after the program finishes. Alhamdulillah, jazakallah. So now it's time to practice, number one. So we will do dhikr. We will start to do dhikr. And there are different colors and ways of dhikr. Different effects of dhikr of Allah. Dhikr of Allah, remembrance of Allah. There's khafi dhikr, silent. There's jahir dhikr, loud, apparent, interior, exterior. So let's take the taste of every dhikr. Let's then take the food, and let's take the langar, and take the different dishes. Because we feel today, I feel that let's take the test. And the person in the buffet, he wants to eat this dish, number 1, 2, 3. All the sweets and the savouries. I feel like feeding you all the foods and the halwa. Then after that, you come to me at the end and say, Hazrat, teach me dhikr. Then there will be some benefit of today's gathering. And my akhira will be made, and your akhira will be made, and praise be to Allah, your darajat, your ranks will be elevated. You heard, you understood. Allah said, you did shukr of my ni'mas. So when we do shukr of Allah by doing this dhikr, and I've invited you, and you've invited me, and we do dhikr, Allah says, I'll give you the ajr. The Allah says, la'azidannakum, I will increase and multiply, I will make you the wali of Allah. Inshallah, you'll depart as the wali of Allah. If you want to save yourself from the sins, you keep going away from the sins, and the stamp of approval comes onto you, then you will be saved. Okay, brothers, so let's go towards dhikr, recite Durood Sharif. Do dhikr with a live heart, because the earth and the heavens have opened up. So many angels have gathered. The angels have gathered left and right, east and west, and have climbed up to the heavens. So don't forget that you don't be snoring on the Day of Judgment. Oh, he was snoring. Fadhkuruni adhkurkum, Allah says. Remember me and I'll remember you.